Welcome to the Dr. Berkson's Best Health Radio Show. And in this segment, we are going to learn about death by regulation. Our guest is Dr. Mary Ruwart, and I had to really learn how to say that name right. And we are going to be learning real shocking information about the FDA, but also she's going to give us options, not just give us doom and gloom, but give us options. Don't forget that you can go to drlindsayberkson.com for show notes, and our guest today has gifts for you, and there's going to be links in the show notes for gifts for you, and I also have a gift for you. You can text 345-345 and then put in sexy brain, and I've written and compiled some fascinating information on oxytocin, the love hormone, which we now know is also the immune system hormone, and the gut hormone. So on the show, we have lots of gifts for you today. A little bit about a preamble of what you're going to hear. Most Americans believe that consumer protection regulation actually keeps us from harm. Unfortunately, this is rarely, if ever, the case. Dr. Mary Ruwart, in her new book, and the title is such a powerful, graphic, Death by Regulation, explains that too many of us in our free country are dying of federal laws, the 1962 amendments to the Food and Drug Act, that were supposed to protect us. So who is Dr. Mary Ruwart? She's a research scientist, an ethicist, a libertarian author and activist. She was even a presidential runner-up on the libertarian ticket. She has been on some real great shows that are favorites of mine. She's been a guest on the Larry King Radio Show, the Morton Downey Show, the Rolanda Show, and we are lucky to have her here today. So welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Lindsay. It's good to be here.
So I'd like you to just dive right in and tell us, what is the message of your book, Death by Regulation, and why did you write this book, and what should people be taking home today?
Okay, well, first I want to give the full title, because you mentioned that there's some optimism, even though the title seems a little intimidating. It's Death by Regulation, How We Were Robbed of a Golden Age of Health and How We Can Reclaim It. And it's the reclaiming of it that, of course, I want your listeners to focus on, because it is possible to reverse this. And basically, what the book says is the 1962 amendments to the Food and Drug Act conservatively took about 5 to 10 years off each of our lives. And in the book, I go through step by step how I calculated that. I was able to calculate it for the impact of the amendments on the pharmaceutical industry. But the really big loss of life, which I wasn't able to calculate, was its impact on prevention. Because what these amendments did, it shifted our medical paradigm from inexpensive prevention to expensive treatment. And it really censored a lot of life-saving information about nutrients and natural substances. And probably that cost us more years of our lives than the 5 to 10 years I've just mentioned that were due to the impact on the pharmaceutical industry.
You're a real biostatistician, so all of these comments that you're making are backed up by facts, and you also worked for many years in Kalamazoo, Michigan. In fact, you went to Michigan State, I went to the University of Michigan, so we've got some of our academic roots are shared. But
yes.
Can you explain, because people are listening and they go, what does this mean? I really thought the FDA was there to protect us. And now you're saying there's some amendments that changed. What happened at that time to do that? And why is it that they are different than what we are being told?
Well, what the amendments did is gave the FDA, I won't say unlimited power, but a lot of power. And the way it was set up, the power grows every year. So these amendments sort of metastasize into the system and are making things worse every year. For example, back before the amendments were passed, it took about 4 years to get a drug from the lab bench to the marketplace. Now it takes somewhere between 12 and 14 years, which is a lot of time. And when the AIDS patients were dying and had no treatments, they were desperate and they knew they couldn't wait that long. So what they did is they hired black market chemists to make the very drugs we were making in the drug companies, and they distributed them throughout the AIDS community. So by the time the FDA gave us permission to test our drugs in people, every AIDS patient in the country that wanted them had already had them and become resistant. we had to wait for the new patients to be diagnosed before we could test our drugs. And if you and your listeners probably saw the award-winning movie Dallas Buyers Club.
Right.
And in that movie, of course, you saw how the FDA prosecuted and persecuted these buyers clubs that were just trying to save the lives of AIDS patients. The ones in California weren't affected too much because they were so tight with the media, the FDA knew it would get bad press if it went after them. But it did go after the loners, so to speak. And the Dallas Buyers Club movie shows that very, very much. And if you look at the numbers, we lost about 15 million people to the delay in getting life-saving drugs from the bench to the marketplace. But that wasn't the biggest problem. The biggest problem for the pharmaceutical industry was the loss of innovation. We know at least 50% of our innovations are lost because they drop out in late-phase testing for economic reasons. In other words, the drug company realizes it's not going to be able to recover its development costs, so it just stops. But then there are many more drugs that are never go into development because the drug company can already predict that they're not going to be able to recover costs. And I can tell you a really interesting story about that. When I was working at Upjohn, the FDA actually called me up, and they were all excited because I had just filed a patent for prostaglandins and liver disease. Prostaglandins are a natural hormone that every cell in your body makes. They're called eicosanoids today, and they are made from basically the building blocks that are in fish oil. So when you're taking fish oil, what you're trying to do is get a good balance of your prostaglandins. You're trying to make more good ones because our American diet really favors making the bad ones. And you know, there's bad, I say bad and good, but of course what they do is create a balance in your body if it's properly done. So anyhow, the FDA said they really wanted to help Upjohn get this product to market because there's nothing for the treatment of liver disease and 100,000 people die every year from it. But the problem is when you have a really new drug, you don't know how much to give. You don't know how often you have to give it. You don't know how many patients you need in your study to get the statistical significance that the FDA wants. And you don't know how many years you might have to treat. It's all very new. So these studies take years. And if you don't guess right the first time, you don't get the statistical significance and you have to start all over again. Well, the company figured out that it was unlikely we could guess right every time and that we'd probably have to repeat the studies, and by that time it would be off patent and we wouldn't be able to recover our costs. And, you know, it's very frustrating because there's probably a lot of cures for many diseases sitting on laboratory shelves that never make it to market because of this. And the development costs are going up every year. That's when I said the amendments are metastasizing throughout the system. What they do is they drive up costs every year.
How do they do that? How does the amendment keep getting worse every year for the phenomena that you're discussing?
Well, what happens is the FDA... basically, the courts have decided the FDA has carte blanche, so it can require as many studies as it wants.
So is that what happened in the 1960s? So the FDA before then didn't have carte blanche,
that's
and then
correct.
After it did. So, I'm going to ask you why as soon as you finish that question, because
sure.
I'd like to know how that happened that they suddenly got carte blanche.
Yes. Well, I'll explain that, too. But, so what happens is the FDA, if you want to think about how they feel about this, you know, no drug is completely safe and effective for everyone. And FDA knows that, the drug companies know that, but Congress doesn't seem to know that. So what happens when something goes wrong and there's a side effect that comes to the attention of the American public, Congress beats up on the FDA. And this isn't really fair to them because if they were only to approve drugs that were totally safe and effective, we'd never get any new drugs. I mean, drugs are powerful, and that's good in a sense because that means they can help you, but it's bad in another sense because it means they can also harm you. And, you know, because we're all genetically different, some of us are going to be harmed by drugs that save the lives of other people, just like people who are allergic to penicillin can die from it, and people who aren't can be saved by it. Now, the 1962 amendments got passed because of something that happened in Europe. there was a drug called thalidomide, which was a safer sleeping drug than barbiturates. People were dying of barbiturate overdoses, accidental overdoses, and thalidomide was indeed safer for adults. But the problem was it wasn't safe for the unborn, and when pregnant women started taking it, they found out it helped their morning sickness, so the company started marketing it for that. Well, the problem was it wasn't safe for the, you know, young child that was in utero, in the uterus. And so some were born without limbs, some just died. And it was a very sad situation. Life magazine had a big spread on these thalidomide babies. And in the U.S., where this didn't happen, except for a few isolated cases where the drug was being tested, there was a lot of angst, and Congress decided to pass these amendments that had been languishing for about 3 years in Congress, because they were really not meant to increase safety. They were meant to insist that genetic drugs be tested for effectiveness, so they were equivalent. Everyone could see whether or not they were equivalent to brand name drugs, because doctors didn't trust generics back then because this testing wasn't done. And sometimes the generics didn't work as well as the brand name drugs. So these amendments really had nothing to do with safety. But what they did is one of the things that relates to what we were talking about earlier is they really made the FDA examiners put their neck in the noose, so to speak, because instead of the drug companies just giving the FDA the data and then the FDA simply not making any objection and the drug company going ahead and marketing, now with the amendments, some FDA employee had to sign on the dotted line for the approval and, of course, thereby put their neck in the proverbial noose. And that made the FDA want to demand as many studies as it could think of to have these drugs tested. So every year, the number of tests and the number of patients that are in our clinical trials grows every year as the FDA thinks up more and more things that maybe they should test to avoid getting in a situation where Congress is going to beat up on them because of side effects.
Can you explain what happened with folic acid and how so many American women went on to have babies born with spina bifida because of this very issue?
Sure. You know, now, of course, these amendments are passed to save babies from getting deformities, right? But one of the things that the amendments did is it said, if you don't have elaborate testing of effectiveness, you can't make a claim for your drug or even for your vitamin. And folic acid was a B vitamin. So what happened with that is in the 1980s, early 80s, we knew that folic acid taken in the first month or two of pregnancy could almost totally prevent spina bifida and other neural tube defects, which are horrific birth defects. Children are usually institutionalized when they have them. Of course, the folic acid manufacturers wanted to tell the American women about this and advise women of childbearing potential to take folic acid as a preventative because, of course, you need it in the first month or two of pregnancy when you don't even know you're pregnant. So the FDA said they would shut down the folic acid manufacturers if they did that. And even when the Center for Disease Control, a whole nother government agency, recommended that young women take folic acid to prevent these birth defects, the FDA told the folic acid manufacturers that if they even mentioned this, they would be shut down. So it was like maybe 12 years.
In other words, if the B vitamin didn't go through the rigorous testing that drugs did, it couldn't make any health claims.
That's
thereby
right.
The FDA is elbowing out natural, preventative, helpful substances to be able to be educated to the public, which is really having better skills and less pills, but but the public is, because of the amendments, that's not how it's set up to inform the public.
That's right. In fact, the FDA actually was sued a number of times by consumer groups, and eventually the FDA got the courts to say if there are any health claims made for a food or a drug, a food or a nutrient, it turns them into drugs. So the
how
FDA,
come the oatmeal companies can say that they're heart healthy? They seem to be the only ones, because I know the FDA's gone after cherry growers, walnut growers, and said, if you say these are heart healthy, we're going to come after you. But why can the oat company, you see the advertisements on TV all the time. How do they have some contacts, some special friends that they schmooze with that they're allowed that safety to do that?
Well, that's a really good question, because they originally did go after the oatmeal manufacturers, but I don't know what they've done to make that shift. Of course, the partial good news on this is there are so many nutrients out there and so many companies involved now that they come very close to making claims, and the FDA can't really monitor them all. So we're getting some information, but we're not getting the kind of information we should, obviously, because there probably are many more stories we could talk about. I mean, you mentioned the cherry and walnut growers. They just basically said on their website, hey, you know, walnuts and cherries contain these nutrients, and the scientific literature shows that these nutrients can be very helpful. And that was all they needed to say to get the FDA to come down on them. So it's very sad, because that's how it's really shifted us from inexpensive prevention to expensive treatment. And in fact, some natural substances have more or less made it through the system. For example, fish oil is such a wonderful nutrient that two companies decided they wanted to somehow get it in as a drug. So what they did is they attached a chemical group to the active ingredients in fish oil. And because this group was attached, this chemical group, it became patentable. So when you take this, your body takes that chemical group off, and you have the nutrients in fish oil.
You know, so, I was just listening to a cardiovascular symposium on Medscape, and they had these doctors from really prestigious institutions saying, only use pharmaceutical grade fish oil. Fish oil's wonderful. It lowers triglycerides. It improves your lipid protein profile, but don't use over the counter. And it's, you know, that's not true that all over the counter fish oils, especially the doctor brands, aren't extremely efficacious.
Well, that's right. In fact, the one that Dr. Barry Sears has, what he calls Omega RX, and you can learn more about him at drsears.com or zonediet.com. The nice thing about his fish oil is he tests it for PCBs, and his PCBs are much lower than that of the prescription fish oil.
Well, but how do you like them there, Apple? Say that one more time, because I just listened to cardiologists from Mass General giving a symposium training, and this was for CEUs, training lots of other cardiologists, saying the opposite. So can you like put parentheses on each end of this and say this out loud?
Sure. Well, of course, I'll have to say that not all fish oil is created equal. But if someone wants to take fish oil, I always recommend Dr. Barry Sears' Omega RX, because he's actually hired a very special chemist in England to make sure that his PCBs were the lowest on the market, and they are. They're lower than PCBs is a contaminant, I should mention, that you don't want in your fish oil, and his are very low.
Polychlorinated bromides, right.
Yeah, even lower than the prescription fish oil. So I actually recommend his, and he sells it in a liquid and in a capsule. So the nice thing about that, the liquid's obviously much less expensive. I take it, and it doesn't even taste terrible. Another problem is a lot of fish oils are oxidized. They aren't kept cool. They have other contaminants that speed up the oxidation. So it really is important to get the right type of fish oil. Now, the interesting thing is it's illegal for Barry Sears to go to doctor's offices and say, my fish oil has less contaminants, because if he did that, he would be making a health claim, and he hasn't put his fish oil through that rigorous process. So this is how we lose out on life-saving information.
You know, this really hits home. When the FDA in 2004 came out and said, you know, we're going to allow herbal drug combinations. So I got really excited, because I formulated Metagenics First Fem line, and I formulated about 11 different nutraceutical lines, because I believe in the power of nutrients mm-hmm. and the power of food.
Yes.
So I've been in on this early on. In the early 1980s, I worked with Metagenics to do their first Fem line. So when the FDA came out with that dictum, I went, oh boy, I want to come up with this. And I went to a nephrologist here in town. I wrote you this on a little note that we started to get to know each other. And his name is Dr. Jack Moncrief. And he co-invented with another scientist at UT the very first home unit of dialysis, continual ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. And so he was a visionary, inventive guy. He's got some catheters named after him. So I had this idea to merge an herb with a pharmaceutical and to use it as a topical on wounds for non-healing wounds in immunocompromised patients. Mm-hmm. So we went to meet with the derm division of the FDA and they were all excited about it, but it turned out to be very efficacious and to really change wound care because you didn't need to go see your wound doctor for debridement. It was very inexpensive, but our competitor at the time was Regranix, which was found to cause cancer with just the, it had an increased incidence of cancer with the application of one tube over a month's time. So after that, they took, instead of having the regulation for a topical that was less rigorous than for oral, they then said all topicals had to go under the regulation that you're talking about for oral. And we hadn't started with that. We didn't have that kind of money. Our drug wasn't expensive. It had long shelf life. Someone could have bought it for $75, kept it in their cabinet. If they have diabetes, they start getting a wound on their toe. They could have used it. But because of what you have to go through, we couldn't do it. We're in the process right now of just closing up that company. It's very sad to me because we had something that was so helpful. We used it in a pilot study and patients in his practice, in his dialysis practice. And so here it is that people are missing out on an inexpensive, very effective medication that could give them a lot more quality of life and peace of mind and do away with some of the invasiveness of today's wound care because of the way regulation is set up.
Yes, that's so true. And that story is multiplied many, many times. And that's part of why we are, when we say we lose innovation, that's exactly what we mean. So it's a very sad story. And, you know, you mentioned the pricing. Well, you know, the cost of drugs to make the actual drug and put it in a pill is usually very small compared to the regulatory costs. In fact, one of the graphs in my book shows that the costs of regulation are directly related to what we pay at the pharmacy for brand name drugs. It's not that drug companies are greedy and they're trying to, you know, promote all the pricing hikes that they can. What it is that the regulatory costs are going up every year. And if they don't cover those costs, they go out of business and there are no new drugs. Now, I will say that there are a couple people that are that are greedy and are out there doing really bad things and giving the drug companies a bad name. And what these are is groups of investors that go and look for generic drugs where there's only one manufacturer still standing. And the reason I say still standing is because there's been a big push on generic manufacturing by the FDA about 10 years ago that really changed the way generics work.
I mean, can you explain what a generic is for people that are listening? They might not know.
Sure. Well, the difference between a generic and a brand name drug is this. A brand name drug is usually put out. It's like a new drug that's put out by a company. And then after the patent expires, it becomes what we call a generic. And then any company can make it if it goes through some additional testing with the FDA. But what happens normally is that the company that made the original brand name drug also makes a form of the generic. And they usually keep that price pretty low because they're really interested in new drugs. That's where their attention is. But when the FDA cracked down on generic manufacturing, a lot of these very older generics stopped being very profitable because, you know, the companies weren't hiking the prices. So a lot of the companies went out of business, and for some generics, there was only one company left that made them. And then a group of investors got together, sought out these companies where these generics where only one company was still making it. And then they got an exclusive license for making and selling that generic.
And then they really hike up the price. Yes, like, look at the EpiPens. That's what's happened with EpiPens. If you go into anaphylactic shock, you go to the pharmacy, it's $400 to $600, $700 to get an EpiPen because of that very scenario.
That's right. And there were competitors for EpiPen that were trying to get FDA approval, but the FDA kept stalling them. So now there are some out there. So now EpiPen is having to lower its prices or giving coupons or something because these other less expensive alternatives are there. But you see, that's what these regulations do. They create cartels and monopolies. And so, you know, then, of course, the people who are greedy can be rewarded for their greed because they can hike prices up and nobody can do anything about it.
It's really a thing that the regulatory path to take a drug to market has become so expensive that natural and less expensive answers can't make it.
That's
and
right.
Medicine has become based more and more on handing out scripts for these meds. And people become leery because their doctor isn't recommending foods or natural answers or vitamins. Or once a vitamin looks like it has promise, they're saying only the pharmaceutical delivery of it, when that isn't necessarily true. So how does a regular person out there listening to all this, with their head is spinning, how do they take some steps to say, how do I maneuver through this to keep myself and my family healthy?
Well, that's a very good question, Lindsay. And what I usually recommend to people, you know, a one-stop shopping at Life Extension, the Life Extension Foundation, lef.org or lifeextension.org, both of those URLs will get you there. I like them because they also have a good quality fish oil, and they are people who really have spent a lot of time making sure their products have what they say they have in the bottle. And they also spend a lot of money on research to see how they can best get their products to be absorbed, because some nutrients aren't very well absorbed in the form they're often given.
Yeah, people don't realize that they only absorb about 50% of what the label says if they have a great digestive tract going on, right?
Exactly, exactly. And they actually fund research to see, you know, what the next step is. And for example, one of the things they did is they found out that, you know, caloric restriction, which is probably the the best way that you can ensure your longevity if it's done properly. If you had caloric restriction, you turned on certain genes. Well, of course, they knew most people wouldn't want to cut back on their eating. So they tried to see if there were any natural substances or drugs that might mimic what caloric restriction was doing. And one of the things they found was the anti-diabetic drug metformin.
Yeah, it lengthens telomeres, right? It turns on autophagological processes. It's pretty amazing. But there is a human trial now called the Caleri trial that's on intermittent fasting, because their small initial trial was so effective that it improved metabolism and looked like it decreased a lot of the markers of potential nasty diseases. Oh,
yes.
Yeah, that's really metformin. You know, there is an herb that has at least one or two randomized controlled trials comparing metformin for some endpoints, not exactly for telomere length. An endpoint is the goal of the study, and that herb is bilberry.
Yes. Yes.
But not everybody can handle bilberry, and not everybody can handle metformin, but there's so many delivery routes of it. Some people
sure.
get diarrhea, but you can take a time release, or you can even take a topical, you know,
yes.
if it really makes your tummy unhappy.
Well, this is why I recommend Life Extension, because they go through a lot of that. And if you have a particular disease or problem, health problem, they have protocols where they talk about all of the different drugs and nutrients that you can take for that. And they emphasize nutrients, but they are very aware of what's going on in the new drug area, and they bring that to the attention of their readership. In fact, Life Extension Foundation, their founders were threatened by the FDA very early on in the 80s because they kept trying to sell and encourage people to become aware of coenzyme Q. Coenzyme Q10. And because it was marketed as a drug in Japan, the FDA felt it should be marketed as a drug here, even though it's a natural substance. And had they succeeded in putting Life Extension Foundation out of business, we might not have CoQ10 in this country. And it's an important nutrient, because if you have to take statins, you really should be taking CoQ10, and most cardiologists will recommend that because they're aware of that, because it helps alleviate some of the side effects in your muscle weakness area that you might have when you take statins. So as you can see, Life Extension Foundation really has a lot going for it.
I just got to ask, are you on the board or something, or what's your relationship with life? You're not...
Well, I've been a customer since they started, and I have to admit I have consulted with them from time to time, and so I know them. I know the firm, and I've been a delighted customer for a long time. I'm probably one of their better customers because we have some genetic issues in my family, and so it's helpful for us to take certain nutrients. So. And I do, like I said, for one-stop shopping for information and product, I recommend Life Extension. Of course, there are other wonderful groups out there, but I think to start out, it's a really good place for the individual.
There are some really great groups. There's Doctor's Lines like Thorne and Pure Encapsulation and Design for Health. And Biotics was one of the very first companies to ever design fish oil. And they, at a number of their symposiums, the government hires them to test other products. And they claim many of these companies, the Doctor's Lines, have independent laboratories testing for adverse contaminants and so forth, like you're discussing. But that is so important in any product that you buy. There's now turmeric is such a big trendy product, and a lot of turmeric comes from India, and in India they sell it by weight. So some of the sellers were adding lead to it, let alone there's lead in their soil. And we've had some patients have all kinds. One woman went into premature ovarian failure, and it turned out that it was really the lead from a turmeric product. So, you want a company that tests all products.
That's right. You want a good company. And you know, that's, again, why I recommend Life Extension. In fact, this actually, if you want a coupon, if your listeners want a coupon for Life Extension, I just wanted to mention that, you know, my book, Death by Regulation, has a special going on. We're going to release it April 10th. But if you order it before April 9th through our site, deathbyregulation.us, you get $60 worth of bonuses. And one of those bonuses is a $10 off coupon for the Life Extension Foundation. And I'm really excited about all this because on April 10th, what we'll do, we'll take all those orders, we'll put them into Amazon at one time. And by doing that, we hope to get Death by Regulation on the Amazon bestseller list. And the reason this is important is because we need to get the word out. I mean, everyone is affected by this, whether we're regulators, pharmaceutical executives, patients, doctors, people who don't want to take any drugs at all. We're all affected by these amendments, and they're shaving 5 to 10 years off our lives. So everybody should be very motivated to get rid of these amendments.
So we really want people to go to deathbyregulation.us. If they purchase the book now, they get $60 worth of gifts. One of them is a coupon for the company Life Extension that you were just talking about. So we want everyone that's out there, we want to support this work. And I would like you, and we're going to say this again and give how to get to the coupons again in just a moment, but can you share a little bit exactly about what you mean that we are shaving so many years off of our life? Where do those statistics come from, and what do you have in your mind when you're saying that?
Yes, and remember, it's a conservative estimate. And the reason it's conservative is because it's just the impact on life-saving drugs, not on nutrition. And of course, as we're talking, nutrition and prevention is the biggie. So remember that it's probably twice what I'm talking about. So what I'm talking about is the delay in getting a life-saving drug from the lab bench to the marketplace. The amendments have added about 10 years to that process. We have a fairly decent idea of how many lives that the drugs that we've put out on the market already save. So we can calculate from that that we've lost 15 million Americans. Now, the loss of innovation.
We've lost 15 million Americans because of these amendments that have given the FDA so much power.
Yeah, and that's just the beginning. That's just from the delay in getting the drugs to market. The loss of innovation is even bigger. If I just say it's 50%, we know it's bigger than that because the studies show 50% dropping out for economic reasons in late phase development.
Like my company. Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. So if we say 50%, instead of 80. And if we say the drugs that we've lost, the innovations we've lost are only 25% as effective as the ones we have now, which is, again, a conservative estimate, that's another 26.7 million people. And then if we just take the loss of information on aspirin, which, of course, you know, basically is used in cardiology a lot, it really is very helpful in heart attacks, that's about 1.7 million lives lost because these amendments suppressed that information for so long. You know, basically,
how did it suppress the aspirin information?
Well, what happened is right after the amendments were passed in the 1960s, Bayer wanted to put out a one-a-day aspirin packet because, you know, the information was already out there that aspirin probably did prevent heart attacks. But the FDA, when they explained what the company would have to do under the amendments, it was so onerous that Bayer gave up. So instead of putting it out there, and it wasn't until the mid-80s, or maybe it was late 80s, I think, when the definitive study that had been funded by the NIH came out and showed that, yes, aspirin is really helping. In fact, it was helping so much that they broke the blind and decided they could withhold this information.
The blind portion of the study.
Yeah, right. Because, you know, it was being so effective that they felt it was unethical to keep this information from the public. So, but we had to wait, you know, 20 some years to, you know, become aware of that information. And about 1.7 million Americans lost their lives that probably wouldn't have had we, you know, had that information out there. So when you add all that up, that's, you know, it comes out to be, you know, half of the Americans who have died from disease have lost roughly 10 or 11 years of their lives, or looking at it another way, we've all lost 5 years. And then if you try to tack on what we assume is probably happening with prevention, you can see how that could easily be doubled.
Boy, so let me tell you, here's what Ron Paul, a medical doctor who is a former U.S. representative from Texas, my home state, and a former candidate for the United States presidency, this is what he had to say, just a summary of his comments on this book that we're talking about now, Death by Regulation by Dr. Ruwart. When I served my many terms in Congress, I was able to see firsthand how the amendments empowered the pharmaceutical cartel, gave the FDA the power to deny Americans access to promising new drugs, and kept Americans from learning about how to prevent disease. As a physician, I found this assault on prevention especially troubling. This is a book you have to go out and buy. You know, I don't push a lot of things on the show. I don't sell. I'm not selling anything yet on this show. But I am saying that this is a book. When I first heard what Dr. Ruwart was doing, I thought, this is a woman whose career overlaps with mine. And this is a book that you need to go out and buy and tell all of your friends about. And I would like you to share, please, Dr. Ruwart, what are some of the positive sides? What are some of the to-dos rather than just the doomsday of, oh my goodness, we've been living with this dark cloud over us. What are the possible answers to get us out of this mess?
Well, obviously, we need to do away with the amendments, but that's just a start because a lot of what happens with the amendments has been now codified in court cases. So to do that, really, we have to take the approval power away from the FDA. In other words, the FDA can make a recommendation and say, we think this drug is good, we think it's bad, but you, as the consumer, should actually have the option to buy the drug at any stage in development if you think it's a good idea. For example, the AIDS patients could have bought drugs directly from companies early on and tried to save their lives. Cancer patients actually sued and tried to get that option. They said it was their constitutional right, but the courts ruled that Americans do not have the constitutional right to save their lives without approved drugs.
It's crazy because there's a doctor in Dallas that's saving lots of people, and he's been, you know, charged by the FDA so many times because what he's doing is using a vaccine that's helped so many people, but he can't get it to go mainstream because of all these issues. So but people will say, people are going to be listening to this and going, well, wait a second. The FDA is supposed to be protecting me, and they're going to protect me against drugs that are dangerous for me that I wouldn't know about. Can you address that and then what the answer might be so people have their fears allayed? Okay.
Sure. And then I want to talk about some of the optimistic things that are happening too. I don't want to leave that. I was just kind of getting started on that, but that's okay. The safety thing. So, unsafe drugs do get to market, and the reason they do is no matter how much testing we do, it's still small numbers of people. And when lots of people start taking the drugs, side effects that we really didn't predict show up. So, you know, every drug has this happen, but some of them have it happen so badly that we withdraw them. So prior to the amendments, we withdrew about 2.5% of our drugs that were approved. After the amendments, that number's like 0.3%. So it's actually gone up.
Wait, we didn't hear that. Anything, how many after the amendments? We didn't hear that.
3.3%.
Thank you.
So actually, I think those numbers probably aren't different, but the bottom line is drugs haven't gotten any safer. In fact, in some ways, they've gotten less safe. Because of the cost of drugs, getting them to market, drug companies generally try to focus on what I call lifestyle drugs, drugs that have to be taken for years, maybe even decades. And of course, our bodies can't always handle that. You know, they can handle something for a couple months, but a couple decades, that's a different story. So, you know, there's been a lot of safety issues. Actually, drugs in a way are less safe than they were before the amendments. But the optimistic thing I want to talk about is that all of this is now becoming visible to the American public because of the AIDS story, because of the cancer patients suing the FDA. What has happened is the Goldwater Institute has been promoting a legislation called Right to Try, which basically would give terminally ill patients the right to negotiate directly with a drug company after a certain point is reached in the development. And it has passed in 38 states. It's now being considered by the U.S. Congress. And I think there's, it's not quite the reform, perfect reform we want, but it's a start, and it's really explaining to people that, you know, there's some problems here with the FDA. Now, coming along, which no one's probably aware of, but they can get a copy of the new book when they get the $60 worth of bonuses when they buy mine, is Free to Choose Medicine by the Heartland Institute. This is actually proposing a two-tiered system, very similar to what I was saying, keeping the FDA on its current track, but after a certain point, after some safety testing has been done in people and just the first stage of effectiveness testing, a drug can enter the Free to Choose Medicine track. And once it does that, it can stay in that track forever. It never needs FDA approval. And the nice thing about that is the FDA can't punish the drug companies for going in that track. Whereas with Right to Try, the companies have to stay in the FDA's good graces. And if they're negotiating directly with the patient, well, FDA might not like that too much and could punish them. So, and it punishes them by dragging their feet in reviewing their data and giving them an approval.
So then how close are we to that track? And what is the name of that track one more time?
Free to Choose Medicine.
Free to Choose Medicine.
Yes, and it, you can get the new book that just came out.
If people buy your book, right?
They buy my book and they get a $5 discount coupon. I think the book is, if I'm remembering correctly, the book is marketing for about $10. So you're basically getting a 50% savings. And so, you know, I really encourage everyone to read that and support that. Because in my book, I suggest, as I said earlier, that we take the approval power away from the FDA. And that's a much more, quote, radical plan.
We do that? How would that even come to see the light of day?
Oh, Free to Choose Medicine or my plan?
Your plan.
Okay. Well, what's going to happen, I'm hoping, is that my book will become popular enough that, you know, people are supporting that plan. They will see Free to Choose Medicine as a more conservative plan, and that will help, I think, Free to Choose Medicine get passed. Now, Free to Choose Medicine isn't quite as, won't be quite as good as taking the approval power away from the FDA, but it's such a strong step in that direction. I think that what will end up happening is most drugs will go through the Free to Choose Medicine track very quickly, and the FDA will become a de facto certifying agency, which is what I'm recommending, that it become a certifying agency rather than a regulatory agency. And the difference for your listeners who might not be aware of it is a certification is kind of like a seal of approval, but you as a consumer can still buy the product if you don't agree with the seal of approval. Whereas with regulatory issues, if the FDA won't approve it, you can't buy it. It's against the law. So, you know, that's not fair. If you're dying of something and you want to try something that's not fully tested, that should be your right. I mean, it's your body. It should be your choice.
So you're saying that in the olden days, drug companies used to give drugs to docs and they would say, tell us if you see issues with patients. And then that would be some of the input they would get to decide not to put that drug out in the market. And if the FDA becomes a certifying agency, when drugs go out, you can choose to get them. And if there's problems with them, what would be the avenue, if there are enough problems of them, to pull that drug off the market, or would just stay and people would just realize that quite a number of people have had certain issues?
Well, you know, before the amendments, we saw that the marketplace was actually pretty efficient about identifying bad drugs and drugs that didn't work. And that's because if you compare studies before and after the amendments, you see that we didn't gain much effectiveness with the amendments, even though we demand so much. And actually, even consumers groups have been able to predict which drugs work and which drugs don't. The Abigail Alliance, which was one of the litigants in this cancer patient initiative against the FDA, they actually have listed 40 drugs that they told the FDA it should be approving a couple years before the FDA actually approved them. So, in other words, the data's out there. People can see it, and people know it a couple years before the drug is allowed to be marketed by the FDA. And that's a pretty good track record. And on the other side, Public Citizen has a best pills, worst pills list. And they have accurately predicted that about 50% of the drugs that they've said are really bad and should be pulled from the market have actually been pulled by the FDA.
Can people go to publiccitizen.com and see this bad pill, good pill list? Public Citizen or Public Citizens, plural.com?
I think it's singular, okay. But it's in my book. You know,
you got to get the book. It's amazing how much we're addicted to the concept. We are so fear-based as a society right now that we are addicted to the idea that we need to be saved and we need to be protected and we need to be more regulated. And what it has done is made so many of us lose out. And book so clearly shows that. You've got to read this book. Can you tell us what this means for nutrients? Because a big part of my career is food and nutrients or medicine. And talk just a little bit about that before we let everybody know where they should go again and put everything to a close. This has been such an exciting show. This is such important information. This is really the basis of so many of my other shows, of what we're talking about is your freedom to have access to nutrition, your freedom to have choice with meds, your freedom to have individual action as a human being, with your rights in this country. And she has put it all together in this book. But if you wouldn't mind just making a few comments on nutraceuticals, because your whole understanding takes you to the importance of them.
Yes. Well, first of all, you know, when I was doing research for the pharmaceutical companies, we didn't have all these genetic tools. And our rats were so healthy because we had titrated their nutrients to make sure they were healthy, right? So to get disease models, we had to actually take nutrients away to make them sick so that we could have so I mean, all the researchers went, okay, so optimal nutrition is really important, so we all exercised, took our vitamins, you know, maintained a good weight. And it was kind of interesting because the MDs who were just doing the clinical trials generally tended to be overweight. They drank a lot, smoked, so you know, they weren't aware of the nutrition aspect. And so but as researchers, of course, we knew it was important, and I wanted to lead with that because I'm sure your listeners know it's important, but just in case anyone has any concerns that maybe it's not, I want to say yes. I mean, that's, you can actually make animals pretty healthy by titrating their nutrients, and we're animals, so that gives you a little hint. So what's happened is because of these amendments, we don't get some information we should. If we went with a system where the FDA did not have the power to approve drugs, they also wouldn't be able to say, oh, that you can't make this health claim for this nutrient. You know, we don't think that's a good idea, and we're taking it off the market, or we're going to prosecute you. They wouldn't be able to do that without a power to approve drugs. That's the power that allows them to keep information, life-saving information in many cases about nutrients from the marketplace. So this is very, very important to be able to do that.
I was just, you know, I deal a lot with nutrition on breast cancer patients, and there are these genotoxic metabolites of estrogen, the 4 series, the quinone series, and there's a number of studies, for example, that show that grape skin, resveratrol, that's the phytochemical inside grape skin, helps clear that out of your system. So it's protective. In fact, the gentleman who came, Dr. Narod, who discovered the Brock genes, was able to show that women who had a lot more grapes in their diet or wine in their diet didn't express those genes as much. The resveratrol is so protective. Yet a company selling that product can't say on the bottle that this is breast health or estrogen health protective. And you might miss out on that if you feel you're high risk. Women always have this in their mind. If your mom had breast cancer, your sister. And this is what you're missing out on because of these amendments. Yet drug companies, look at the TV ads. You're bombarded with these ads nonstop. That's what becomes more comfy to you. And food and nutrients to help heal you becomes more wary or suspicious or uncomfy, because exactly what Dr. Ruwart has written this book about. I am really so excited, and I really hope everybody out there purchases this book and tells everyone else, and let's get her first on Amazon as a bestseller. So can you give all the links and everything again? And then when you go to the show notes to drlindseyberkson.com, I'll have a write-up. I'll have the links there again if you're driving in the car or whatever and you can't write them down. And remember to text 345-345 and then put in sexy brain, because I've got a gift for you too. But please, let's hear the last, and we're just about to say goodbye. I feel like I could have her over for dinner and speak for hours, but you've been able to enjoy now almost a little under an hour.
Yes. So if your listeners want their $60 worth of free gifts, they should go to deathbyregulation.us, order the book. They'll immediately get an autoresponder that gives them the digital gifts. And then if they can do that before April 9th, what's going to happen on April 10th, me and my team are going to put in all of the orders at once on Amazon. This will hopefully shoot it up to the Amazon bestseller list, and then Amazon itself will market the book somewhat for me. And that's a good thing because, you know, obviously this affects everybody. And unless we get a lot of attention for the book, nothing's going to change, and we're going to keep having this loss of life. But if we can get everybody excited about changing it, and everyone's affected, so everyone should get excited, I think we can make a big difference.
This is really something that's so important, and it's time sensitive. So we're putting this show out in order for you to really take action on this, so we spread the word. And remember, Dr. Ruwart is such an amazing person. She has her internet column, Ask Dr. Ruwart, which is a popular feature of the Advocates for Self-Government Liberator online. She does so much for so many, and now we want to help her continue on that path. Thank you so much for being on the show today, Dr. Mary Ruwart. This has really been important. Go to the show notes if you haven't got those links, because we want to support her, and you heard it here. God bless you, and bye-bye.